A very good morning to you. Welcome to BBC One. The time is approaching 6 o'clock as we join Nicholas Witchell and Tanya Sillam for the BBC Breakfast News.
This day, with high hopes and brave hearts, in massive numbers, the American people have voted to make a new beginning.
Good morning to you. Bill Clinton has won. He will be the next president of the United States. These are the headlines at 6 o'clock on Wednesday, the 4th of November. 12 years of Republican rule from the White House have ended. Bill Clinton, the Democrat from Arkansas, has scored an overwhelming victory. Mr. Clinton has won 31 states so far. He promised a new direction and a reunited America. President George Bush said he had fought the good fight. He was gracious in defeat.
America must always come first, so we will get behind this new president.
The independent Ross Perot won no states, though he got 18% of the popular vote.
Good morning from Washington. In the next hour, the story of how America said this resounding no to 4 more years of George Bush, and why, after 16 years, they chose to send a Democrat to the White House. Bill Clinton, who said that his mission was to create a reunited States. Peter Snow will be joining me to illustrate how the political map has been altered so dramatically by this election, where Bill Clinton's votes and his victory came from. And from our correspondents around the country, we'll be hearing the reaction in the Bush camp, what Bill Clinton's priorities will be once he enters the White House in January, and we have Ross Perot and an examination of whether his political days are ended. He clearly doesn't think that they have. Join me later for all of that during this program, live from Washington.
Plus, one other headline this morning. At Westminster, the Tory rebels are confident of defeating the Europe motion tonight. They say they have well over 30 firm pledges. The government say that they are still hopeful of victory.
Governor Bill Clinton of Arkansas is to be the next president of the United States. George Bush is out after only one term as president. The Republicans are out after 12 years in the White House. The Democrat victory was overwhelming. It means that in 2 months' time, on January the 20th, Bill Clinton will be sworn in as the United States' 42nd president. This is how the political map of America has been redrawn. The turnout was the biggest since 1960. The results so far show how Bill Clinton, who's colored red here, has captured 31 of the 50 states, with the remainder still to declare. President Bush and the Republicans in blue have been left with just 8 states, most of them in the South and the Midwest. The independent candidate, Ross Perot, failed to capture a single state.
But in terms of the votes actually cast, the result is much closer. Governor Clinton had 44% of the popular vote against 39% for President Bush and 18% for Mr. Perot. But when those votes are translated into the Electoral College, which elects the president, Mr. Clinton's lead is overwhelming. 270 votes are needed to win. Bill Clinton finished the night with 363 Electoral College votes, and President Bush only 64, down from 426 in 1988.
In his acceptance speech a short time ago, Governor Clinton promised a new partnership for a new America. We begin our coverage in Little Rock, the capital of Governor Clinton's state of Arkansas, from where Martin Sixsmith reports.
More than a year after entering a race that few gave him a hope of winning, Bill Clinton had swept to victory, and the president-elect could hardly contain his elation. On the steps of the Little Rock State House with Vice President Al Gore, their wives and their children, he delivered an acceptance speech imbued with his vision for a new America in a new era.
This election is a clarion call for our country to face the challenges of the end of the Cold War and the beginning of the next century. To restore growth to our country and opportunity to our people. To empower our own people so that they can take more responsibility for their own lives.
Bill Clinton identified the nation's mood of dissatisfaction, he promised change, and now the nation has trusted him with the responsibility of bringing that change about.
You all spoke with equal voices for change, and tomorrow we will try to give you that. You can trust us to wake up every day remembering the people we saw in the bus trips, the people we saw in the town meetings, the people we touched at the rallies tonight.
Bill Clinton had gracious words for George Bush, but his thoughts now were firmly on the future.
Together we can do it. Together we can make the country that we love everything it was meant to be. I still believe in a place called hope. God bless America. Thank you all.
It's cold and wet in Little Rock, but Bill Clinton has promised America a bright new morning, and the crowds here seem determined to stay out and see it. The biggest street party in Arkansas's history, echoing similar scenes across the nation as America changes its political guard. For Bill Clinton, the months of grueling campaigning have brought the ultimate reward. Now he must fulfill his promise of an efficient transition, a running start to his presidency, and immediate action on the nation's pressing problems. Martin Sixsmith, BBC News, Little Rock, Arkansas.
It was a kinder, gentler George Bush after the bitterness of the campaign who came out to concede defeat. Despite the humiliation of the landslide against him, losing to a man whose very patriotism he had questioned, Mr. Bush put politics aside and spoke as a statesman.
The people have spoken, and we respect the majesty of the democratic system. I just called Governor Clinton over in Little Rock and offered my congratulations. He did run a strong campaign. I wish him well in the White House, and I want the country to know that our entire administration will work closely with his team to ensure the smooth transition of power. There is important work to be done, and America must always come first. So we will get behind this new president and wish him well.
As the man who won three wars, Panama, Iraq, and the Cold War, Mr. Bush's popularity collapsed in bewildering fashion over 18 months. He dwelt not on the past, but on the future for the children of America.
I remain absolutely convinced that we are a rising nation. We have been in an extraordinarily difficult period, but do not be deterred, kept away from public service by the smoke and fire of a campaign year or the ugliness of politics. As for me, I plan to get, I'm going to serve and try to find ways to help people. But I plan to get very active in the grandchild business.
But America had something on its mind and called eloquently for change, though Vice President Quayle, his eye on 96, said Republicans had nothing to be ashamed of.
We did win the Cold War. America is stronger and safer than ever before. And this president rallied the world in the first post-Cold War crisis to make sure that aggression would not stand.
Beyond his grandchildren, the president has made no secret that there are fish to be caught, and he's been buying new equipment to catch them. The last president of the World War II generation is bowing out with dignity. Gavin Esler, BBC News, Washington.
It was a typical exit, Ross Perot dancing with his family to his theme song, Crazy. The man who spent $60 million of his own money campaigning as an independent was proud in defeat. Although beaten into third place, he congratulated Bill Clinton and thanked his own supporters for around 18% of the popular vote, a record for a third-party candidate.
I want want to thank all of you who are here tonight and all the people who have come together across the nation. Starting last February, you did something that everybody said couldn't be done. Millions of you came together to take your country back.
As late as yesterday, Perot was claiming he could win all 50 states in the event he failed to pick up a single vote in the Electoral College. But he collected more than 11 million popular votes and still sees his supporters as a permanent force in American politics.
The best is in front of us, believe me. This is no time to get discouraged. This is no time to throw in the towel. This is the time to redouble our efforts and work with the new administration to make sure that our country is a beacon to the rest of the world.
He offered his services to the American people for as long as they might be needed.
And I am available to you anytime, any place, anywhere, as long as I'm around.
Perot, clearly encouraged by his performance, won't be ruling out another independent challenge in 96. Laurie Mayer, BBC News, Washington.
In London, 2,000 people gathered at the American Embassy for the traditional election night party. Supporters of Bill Clinton began to celebrate as the early results were reported. Clarence Mitchell was there.
I've had a dream that's coming true.
In the US Embassy in Grosvenor Square, the largest all-American party in town. Hundreds of Democrats and Republicans alike mingled together, along with many British politicians, all waiting to hear the outcome and to assess what a Clinton presidency would mean for Britain.
We very much hope to keep the good, close relationship that Britain and the States has had in recent years.
I think we've got a president who wants to see change. I think his whole manifesto has been about meeting the new challenges of the future, and I think it's something that would be welcome in a Britain that is looking for change itself.
Within minutes of the polls closing, Mr. Clinton's victory became clear.
He's tried to stress continuity. He's made it very clear that he supports free trade and free trade agreements, that he's not a protectionist, very strong on defense, very strong on the commitment to Europe, although at reduced levels.
It's now 4:20 in the morning, London time, and according to the American networks, Bill Clinton is just 5 electoral votes short of securing the presidency. For his supporters here, it can't come soon enough. As he reached the winning total, Democrats were ecstatic.
I see it as a whole new era. It gives such hope to our country. It's New York.
Republicans were devastated, predicting that Britain will suffer.
It's going to hurt our economy here in Britain. You're going to see protectionism, you're going to see isolationism.
America's voted for change. Whether that will also affect its relationship with Britain isn't yet clear.